Hello, hello everybody, and welcome to the pre-show show for the morning. You'll notice that at this time of the morning, we talk very quietly indeed, because we don't want to be too excited. It's good to be ease into the day, I feel, don't you, David?
Yes,
because if we get too excited early in the day, well, there's nothing left for the rest of the day. Now, this is what we call the pre-show show, everyone, which means the show before the show. This is so that you know that we're live, because you might not know that we were live when we went live. It's also so that you can click on the bell. The bell you will find below the subscribe button on YouTube. Yes. Then it will send you an alarm. You will get a loud alarm. It is next to the subscribe button. You'll get a very loud alarm when we go live, if you don't know that we are live. It's all rather confusing. Now, Louise in the final control tells me that it is 21 degrees Celsius, 71 degrees Fahrenheit today. Will fall gently from the sky, followed by a scorching 35 degree, roughly 93 or so Fahrenheit later on today. Byron would have done the pre-show show, but he was just getting himself a little bit of water, and so he is going to start the show in the next little while. Oh, there is an animal. I wonder what kind of an animal it is. I think, given that it is large and grey and has an extended schnoz, it's probably an elephant. It is. David, it's a number of elephants. Thank you, John in Connecticut. Sort of thank you, of course. You say 2 a.m. there was nothing going on at the dam cam. Thank you, John. Is that to say that there was something going on at the dam cam for the rest of the night? History doesn't relate. We'll never know, David. We'll never know. Red lorry, yellow lorry, red lorry, yellow lorry, red lorry, yellow lorry, red lorry, yellow lorry. David, do you know what the new mouth-warming exercise is?
No.
It is to say a black leather jacket, yellow leather jacket. Black leather jacket, yellow leather jacket, black leather jacket, yellow leather jacket, black leather jacket, yellow leather jacket, black leather jacket, yellow leather jacket. And what was the other one from Anchorman? It was the Torchman did not get a fair trial. What was it again? I don't remember. Ah. The Human Torch was denied a bank loan. 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 The elephants are going down to the south. There they go. The Human Torch was denied a bank loan. 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 Oh my goodness, there's an elephant sitting on its bottom. I nearly said the bottom word that begins with an A, but luckily I didn't. Okay, everybody, we're going to say goodbye to you now. We're going to hand it back over to Byron, and he's going to start the show properly. Thank you. See you later.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
This wildebeest is still moving around on the clearings from last night, enjoying the green grass. We are in search of some animals this morning, and this is Safari Live.
Ready?
Standing by.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Safari Live. My name is Byron, and on camera this morning with me is Brian and the very well-known Thumb. And we've got Louise and Kirst in final control this morning. And you may have seen James already on the other vehicle with Dave. You'll probably see them shortly again. And it is a cloudy morning, very, very overcast. If you have a look around us, it's about 22 degrees Celsius, or about 71 degrees Fahrenheit this morning. So cool morning, but it does still feel very muggy, quite humid, and the air just feels very, very thick. We are in search of some animals this morning. My plan is to try and find the lions that Taylor was with yesterday, see what they're up to, if they manage to finish that buffalo. So we're going to start heading down there, and then and we'll find out shortly what James is up to. I'm not sure what his plan is for the morning just yet. So let's see what the morning holds for all of us. Don't forget, everybody, we are completely live, and everything we see out here, you see back home as we see it. So please don't forget, you can send us your questions or your comments either via Twitter at hashtag Safari Live, otherwise email us with questions at wildearth.tv, and we'll happily answer your questions, and we love hearing from all our viewers. And we're going to stick to our plan now, head into that area where we think the lions are. While we do that, James is still sitting with those elephants. Let's go say hi to him.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to this end of the Sunrise Safari. There are two very special elephants. My name is James Henry. I'm not very special at all. David is on camera. David, almost late today, but we thought he'd overslept, but actually he hadn't. What were you doing, David?
I was making coffee.
You were making coffee. Well, why shouldn't he? It was very early in the morning. Now, please do talk to us, of course, over the next 3 hours or so. Hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. I must apologize for the fact that we went suddenly offline yesterday. There seems to be some kind of bizarre electrical fault that happened, and that's why we went offline yesterday about 40 minutes early. So sorry about that. We will attempt to broadcast to you for the full 3 hours this morning. In the final control, Louise Pavide is in my ear. Kirsten McLennan-Smith is pushing the keys and twiddling the knobs and turning the ratchets and doing all sorts of technical things. And Connor Teagues, poor fellow, young man that he is, has had to avail himself or disavail himself of his bed this morning. And he too is knocking about trying to figure out what happened yesterday. So that's the team on the ground today. You've met Byron and Brian, of course, already. A beautiful, calm, early morning it is. It's so still. There isn't a breath of wind at all. The elephants are totally relaxed around us. This young bull is just heading off with his friends. And it's quite a large herd that's just feeding quietly along parallel with the main access road at Juma, possibly down to the water to have a bit of a drink. But it is so completely and utterly still, it's wonderful. And a sort of smattering of interesting bird call. It's not a cacophony, it's a just a smattering, interesting little pockets of sound coming from around the place. One or two crombics in the background. It's almost like a large orchestra that's been, you know, with only one or two players from each section starting up. There's the crombic. David, can you see this Cambritum bush next to us?
Yes.
beyond it and through there. There's a bird sitting on the kind of tallest tree that we can see. That's up a bit. That's it. There you are. Now, it's going to look a little bit grainy because this is a sort of difficult time of the morning. There's not much light. That is a Le Valien, no, at least a Jacobin cuckoo, everybody. Now, we know the difference between this and the Le Valiens by the fact that this one doesn't have stripes on its chest. Now, the Le Valiens cuckoo used to be called the striped cuckoo, but it was much too obvious to call it the striped cuckoo, so they've changed it to the Le Valiens cuckoo. That is the Jacobin. How that is a Jacobin cuckoo, what it had to do with Jacobins, I'm not really sure, but that's what it is. And it will be looking for a mate, and then, of course, they will do the dastardly cuckoo deed of invading another bird's nest and laying their eggs in it. And that little family of birds will raise a bird, that particular cuckoo, even though it is much bigger than its host. And its host is... its host is... I was hoping to find it. It was bulbuls, that's right. I remember now. There are not many bulbuls here, but there are a lot of Jacobin cuckoos, so I'm not really sure if they don't possibly use other hosts as well. Let me just go down to the more... a full description. We've got dark cap bulbul, cape bulbul, fiscal, somber green bull, blah, 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 drongo. They will do the drongo as well. I've often seen them around drongo, so I suspect quite strongly as it flies off that it also uses the fork-tailed drongo here because bulbuls are not very common at all. Now, David, there is a much more vast elephant sneaking up on us from the left-hand side. Him moving gently through there. And thank you everybody for your screenshots of the elephants this morning. Oh, it's a lovely fresh morning, but there is a sort of element of mugginess in the air, which I quite like. Oh, that's a much bigger bull just lurking on the fringes of this herd, staying in probably visual but definitely audible contact. He's probably, I always get this slightly wrong, but I would say he's about 10 feet at the shoulder. He's pretty big. Very nice. Let's have one more look as these chaps move off. And then my plan this morning is to head to the north and then down the eastern boundary and then the southern boundary. Just see if we can't pick up some shadow tracks in the east, perhaps some Karula tracks in the south. And perhaps some Tingana tracks anywhere. That would be nice. Byron is off to try and find the Nkahuma pride. Okay, shall we carry on, David?
Mm.
Good. Now, the one part of Sandy in Canada's question I can answer, the other part not really sure about. Sandy, you say, very, very good question. You say, do elephants actually eat the thorns that they chew on, or do they spit them out? And if they do eat them, why don't they rip the gut to pieces? Do you find the thorns in their dung? I think, Sandy, that they do eat the thorns, and I think it's simply a fact of that they chew them. And that's why they're broken up into small pieces, and that's why they don't harm the gut. Certainly, I've never seen them spit them out. They probably avoid eating the really sort of sharp, long, white ones, and they do bite off those... they do bite off those branches, but I think they probably don't eat too much in the way of those thorns. They certainly eat the thorns of Sisyphus, or the buffalo thorn, which would hurt our hands, but they give them a good chew, and then I think they probably blunt them substantially before they head down into the digestive tract. Nice one, I've never thought of that. Right, Byron is on his way to the lions. Let's find out how close he's got, and I will see you on the western boundary.
So we're still making our way towards the lions, everyone. We've got about another 5 minutes or so before we get into that area. But it is nice just driving around this beautiful cool morning, overcast cool morning. As I said earlier when we started the show, it was still quite muggy, very thick humidity, and the air just feels very thick. However, driving now, the breeze is much cooler. I'm contemplating putting a jacket on. Brian, you got a jacket on already? Let's see what we can find. I'm glad James got to see those elephant. I saw signs of elephant. We just passed through the Mowati, the drainage line, very prominent drainage line, which runs through Juma. We saw a lot of elephant tracks down there, but didn't see any. Lots of sign of elephant around. Oh, hang on. Oh, the brakes this morning. Hang on, everyone. I've just spotted something lying down off to our left. Oh, there we go. Let me just move forward a bit for you, Brian. How's that? Look, there's some buffalo, everyone. Just lying down, still resting. Looks like a small group of females. That's interesting. It's unusual to see small groups of female together like this. Usually you'll find them in larger herds. I think with the little food around at the moment, there is still a very little food around. This buffalo probably split away a lot more looking for food or in search of food and water. You could see a little oxpecker jumping around there. I think it's disappeared now. There we go. All spotted, Brian. Beautiful red-billed oxpecker picking off the ticks and the little fleas on these buffalo. And there it goes. You can see now ruminating or chewing the cud. You can see that that buffalo, that buffalo cow, it's a female. She's probably regurgitated some food and now re-chewing it to break it down even further. And she will then swallow it again. Very efficient digestive system. So she's busy ruminating, as they say. Well, we'll leave these buffalo to rest and we'll continue heading towards the lions, who are potentially still feeding on a buffalo. I'm interested to see if there is any meat left, because in the past they seem to have finished these buffalo fairly quickly when they are feeding. So let's go and see it. I mean, it would be interesting. I don't know if there was a male there yesterday. I think so. I can't remember. I know Taylor was with them, and I think it was just the five lionesses and the cubs. So it'll be interesting to see how much of that kill is actually left. Or perhaps if the males met up with the pride during the course of the evening. That does happen at times. Oh, look. African cuckoo just flew off. Sorry, everyone, I just spotted, I heard him calling. But there's a giraffe here too. Wow, it's all happening. Let me move forward quickly for you. A giraffe, that African cuckoo was calling, and I just spotted him as it flew off. But there's a beautiful giraffe. And the sound of the hardy dar ibis behind us. Listen to that, everyone. And nice to see a big male giraffe moving around feeding. I understand that some of our viewers could hear lions calling last night, potentially the males. And I'm trying to think if I heard them last night. I did hear lions calling in the distance last night when we headed off to bed. See this giraffe, watch out. It's incredible to see how they use their tongues while they are feeding, wrapping a tongue around the branches and the leaves and stripping the leaves off. There is also an oxpecker or two sitting on the giraffe. These oxpeckers sit on most of these animals, picking off the ticks. So they're really playing a vital role within the ecosystem. And off he goes. Wonderful. I love driving around like this, where you're just not sure what you're going to bump into, and things just start happening around you. I mean, the buffalo and the giraffe, it's wonderful. It really is great to take a safari like this, where things just start popping out and basically saying good morning. James, you saying since there's not not a lot of situations or times where animals die of old age in the area, because generally the lions do hunt animals that are a bit older and a bit weaker, but easier to hunt. But we've seen that these lions at the moment have been focusing a lot more on the buffalo. And you're saying that you haven't really seen these... don't run away. Little warthogs just off to the left. There's one just hiding. There's the adult. A little bit shy this morning. So James, you wanted to know what would be the major cause of death with giraffe and that. Well, it is old age essentially. Probably not feeding as much. You know, I think their teeth also get worn down slightly, so it's a bit harder for them to get all the nutrients that they need. I recently saw an old giraffe, a very, very old giraffe, that went down and drank at a waterhole. And because it was old, the legs were a bit weak. It wasn't able to carry its body as well. And what actually happened was this giraffe had slipped into the waterhole and just couldn't get up, didn't have the energy to get up, and it ended up drowning in this little pan, which is, I mean, it was very sad to see, but that's probably what would happen to these animals when they get a bit older. Something like that would happen, and that would cause it to die. The lions eventually found it, and they did feed on it, so... you know, it could be a number of things, James, but... I do think that if they are a bit older and weaker, the lions will still find them and most likely hunt those animals. That African cuckoo is still calling in the distance. Okay, we're not too far from those lions. We're going to still make our way into that area, and as soon as we find them, we'll update you. I think while I do that, head over to James and just see where he is and what he's up to.
We are scanning everybody for a bird that is making a noise. It's going... But I don't know what it is. Yeah, I found it. It is... a white-browed scrub robin. David, you can see the tallish tree in front of us.
Yes.
Right? That one there, yes. Zoomy into that one. Toppy, up a bit. There it is, to the right. Stop. Yeah. Bang him. I've never heard them do that before. I'm 99.99% sure that that is the white-browed scrub robin. Of course, I'm now beginning to doubt myself because I've never heard it make that sound, which is just embarrassing because the white-browed scrub robin is a bird I've seen many times. But I'm just going to, while you look at it and appreciate its beautiful morning song, I'm going to look in my book to make sure that it is. And I must be honest with you, of course, I should have probably just looked at my book without telling you. But now you know of my discomfort. It is most assuredly the white-browed scrub robin. Indubitably. It's a good word, that, David. Indubitably. You should try and use it in a sentence. The other, I mean, apart from the fact that the call is not one that he makes very often, I'm sure he's attempting to mimic another bird. The thing to sort of remember or to note is the fact that he's just repeating the same thing again and again and again and again. And the white-browed scrub robin likes to do that. Him just having a bit of a stretch, putting his feathers in line before he has a fly, shaking out the cold from the night. And he's singing for the ladies, he's singing to detract other males from coming into the area. He's still on the same tree, just to the right, to the left, sorry. Up a bit, middle of frame, just to the right. There you are. Isn't that lovely? Very nice shot, David. Nice blurry background. Now, for some reason to me, everybody, it feels like a Saturday. It is not a Saturday, of course. Today, I believe, is election day in the United States. So, well, you know, good luck to all of you going out to vote. And I hope that you do go and vote. And, well, I hope the best candidate for the world and the world peace wins. You know, we don't want the leader of the free world to be knocking about, well, causing damage. Oh, there's some zebras in there. Hello, Bill. You say it amazes you. It amazes you how you feel like you're sitting right behind us, right behind the presenters while we're driving along. Well, Bill, that's not the best zebra sighting in the world. It amazes me that you feel the same way, and it, of course, it feels like taking a game drive often. You know, you turn around and you look into, I'm looking into your eyes now, Bill, and talking to you because of your comment, and it is an astounding thing that we have been able to achieve through various technological wizardry. A friend of mine used a wonderful term the other day. He said, Hollywood whiz-bangery. And this is very much a Safari Live whiz-bangery that takes and brings you what we're bringing you now. Now, there is a Cokey Franklin just sitting on the edge of that. No, to the left. Can you hear it, David? It's just next to that dung pile. There, zoom in. Right. There you are. Gorgeous. Golden-headed Cokey Franklin. Isn't that beautiful? Right. Byron has some very large elephants to show you. Let's go and find out what they're going to eat for their breakfast.
Have a look at this. This is a massive bull elephant, everyone. Look at him. Wow. He is seriously impressive. Ooh, little bit of a shake of the head there, little bit of a warning. And I could just tell he wasn't aggressive, but he didn't want us to come any closer, so I've stopped a little bit away from them. And there is a whole herd following this big male, which is unusual. But every now and then the big males, big dominant males, do meet up with the herds. And what they often do, and what he has done right here, is he has pushed over this little tree, as you can see there, and you see how the younger elephant, the smaller elephant, are coming through to feed on the leaves. So he's basically getting some food for them and saying, the nice leaves are all at the top, let me push this over for you so you can all feed on it. And this is really, really wonderful. There we go, there's another young one. Like I said, I don't want to move too much because he didn't seem aggressive, but I could tell this male didn't want us to come too much closer. Beautiful set of tusks. Very, very thick. This is an old bull, everyone. I would guess this big male is probably around 35 to 40 years old, perhaps, judging by the size and the tusks. Maybe even a bit older. Want to watch him carefully. Like I said, you know, the whole thing with a lot of these big animals and elephant especially, they're generally very relaxed, but you do still have to be very respectful of them. And that big male, and it's so funny, I don't know how to describe it, everyone, because I love elephants so much. Wow, look at that. He really is incredibly big. This is spectacular. And as I was saying, I don't know what it is. Just listen to the branch weight. Oof. Gee, just so much power. And just driving up, I saw this elephant, and just the way he stopped and he turned a little bit, I just got a feeling from him that he didn't want us to come any closer. And you know, we always speak about it and say, if you get a feeling like that, you need to trust yourself. You need to listen to those feelings because they're usually right. No point in trying to bother the male or try to get too much closer, especially if he's not happy. The rest of the herd seem very relaxed too. You can see there's a young one feeding on those little leaves. Oh my word, he's just sat down. Oh, that is wonderful. Look at that. Isn't that fantastic, everyone? Just thought, well, this is a good spot to lie down. That is beautiful. And that again just shows how relaxed they are. It's just wonderful to sit here and listen to these elephants feeding. Just hear the branches breaking slightly. There were definitely a few more elephant further back. I could just see some trees moving. They've stopped now. They're probably 100 meters or so away. And I'm sure they're following the rest of this herd. Can't see them at the moment though. This is really, really a wonderful sighting. I think, everyone, we got to see that big male and these other Eddie's feeding. Look, that one's resting. See, and I've had this question many times before, if elephants do sleep lying down, and they do indeed. Look at that, that one's resting, lying down completely. And I've seen these big males, I've seen go and lie down too. Often what they try to do is they may do it against a termite mound or something. So there's a bit of a slope, so a bit easier for them to get up. But they do lie down and they do rest. Not often, but they do. I think we're going to leave these elephants, let them continue feeding. We're going to carry on making our way towards the lions, see if they are still around there. While I do that, James has got some more elephants for you to see.
We do indeed have some more elephants. Now, I was just saying to David how wonderful it is that there are so many elephants around at the moment. Of course, we know that they won't be here all the time. They move quite widely. And so we'll just appreciate them while we have them here. Now, that cow has got a substantial set of tusks. And just watch her trunk carefully. It's just turning towards us, having a bit of a sniff. Now, I remember seeing her yesterday, and I'll tell you how, as we watch her smelling us. That's what she's doing there. And if you look at her tusks, her left one is broken off slightly, and you can see it's almost been, looks like it's been purposely sharpened to a point, which it obviously hasn't. But that rapier tusk makes her very obvious and very clearly and easily recognized. So I think, I can't remember where I saw her yesterday. It was somewhere around here. And in fact, I think did we not open the show with her yesterday? Anyway, she was around here and she's easily recognizable by that very sharp left tusk. Now, I know where we saw her. We saw her on the Biffles Hook cut line. She was going north into Biffles Hook yesterday afternoon. Now, Virginia, there are probably 15,000 or 17,000 or so elephants in the Kruger Park area, in the Greater Kruger Park and Greater Limpopo Transfrontier Park, which is all a bit of a mouthful. And that is a lot of ivory, of course. And you say, what happens to the tusks when they die? Well, Virginia, I think the vast majority of elephants we do not find when they die. They tend to go and sort of pop their clogs in a private capacity. They'll go and find a quiet spot on a river and slowly die there. If they are found, what happens is that the ivory is cut out of the skull and taken and put into a stockpile. But if they're not found, and I suspect the vast majority of elephants that die are not found, their tusks, like their bones, either rot away slowly over the years, or they just disappear into the rivers and down under the soil. And I guess there must be a huge amount of ivory lurking about in the ground around this place. But I think most of it just doesn't get found, you know. And of course, on the subject of ivory, we know that this area used to be blessed with probably much larger tuskers. And those tusks used to, in some cases, reach the ground. And very few of those animals exist anymore, and that's because, of course, we shot them all way back in the 19th century. Ali, you say this is wonderful. You love spending time with elephants. Well, I love spending time with elephants too, mainly because, for some strange reason, be it imagined or otherwise, I really feel like we have an ability to communicate with them on some level. I mean, I haven't discussed anything of particular note with an elephant. I haven't discussed the state of the weather or La Nina or whether or not it's going to be a wet year. But certainly there is a connection there. There is an understanding of some sort, which every time I sit with elephants, obviously it's a chance to perhaps get closer to understanding what that is. And I think that's why many people love spending time with elephants. They are all around us, everybody, right and left. And she's just still smelling us. David, did you put on a new aftershave this morning? A new cologne? Not. Rishi, you're interested in whether we were following on this, the theme of if they die, when they die, of course. Everything must die eventually. You want to know if predators will eat them? Yes, they do. Predators will absolutely eat elephants, and they will probably be opened up by lions and hyenas. And once that's happened, then the vultures and the jackals will come in. Look at that. Astoundingly dexterous. She's just fiddling there. She's just kind of having a bit of a think, probably. And I suppose a bit like us fiddling with a pencil or something. When you're thinking, you might doodle a bit on a piece of paper. That's what that elephant's doing there. And she was actually quite careful of us yesterday, I remember. She put herself between us and the rest of the herd. So I think she is definitely listening to my voice. An elephant is a very good meal when it pops its clogs for other animals. Now, apparently there's some impala shouting just outside the Democratic Republic of Congo. That's the camp that we live at. It's not too far from here, so we're going to drive there quite quickly and see what we can find. I'm just going to let Aubrey know on the radio. Aubrey or Taxon, come in. We're just going to go past all these beautiful elephants. Sorry, chaps. And see if there isn't a predator there. Maybe some wild dogs heading towards quarantine. There are impala alarming outside the DRC. We've just got a report from Final Control, so maybe if you're in the area, we're heading that way now. Right, while we drive past all of these impala, we're obviously going to be looking for impala lambs. I unfortunately am now a day out by my reckoning. I said yesterday I thought there might be some. Right, Aubrey's in the area there, so he's also going to have a check, at least Taxon. Okay, copy. Of course, the trick is not to drive too fast so that you miss things on the way there, but at the same time, driving fast enough. Donald, I missed your question, I'm afraid. How big is? Oh, how big's the park? The park's enormous, Donald. It's part of 8.5 million acres, 3.5 million hectares of contiguous wildlife land. So that's a massive, massive area, about the size of Israel. No, more than the size of Israel, about the size of Wales. And we are on the western fringes of it. We can't drive that whole 8.5 million acres. We're not allowed to explore sort of willy-nilly, as it were. We have to stay on about 8,500 acres or 3,500 hectares on the western fringes of the Kruger and sort of centrally. So it's a very, very big wilderness area, and of course the animals are free to come and go as they please. There are no fences between us and the rest of this great wilderness. Thank you, Donald, for that. It's always important to kind of just ground ourselves as to where we are, orientate, or orient, as you say in America. There are some zebra there. We're going to go straight past them and keep going. I'm sorry, I'm really struggling to hear the Final Control. Sorry, Louise, you're going to have to go again with that. Sounds like a fascinating question. Okay, Rais, your question, I'm just going to repeat it verbatim, is if life evolved in order to exploit habitats, what is the... why is there such a diversity within one habitat? I think that's the... Sorry, one second. Taxon's just hearing those alarm calls. I'll get to you now, Rais. Sorry, Tax, confirm what you got there.
I'm just saying that I will check that area there, but so far I can't see anything.
Okay, copy. I'll check quarantine. We'll check quarantine, everybody. Okay, copy. Taksim hasn't seen anything yet. Right, Rais, it's a question of the fact that a habitat, of course, I mean, depends on what scale you're looking at it. So if we're looking at the world, excuse me, not looking in the eye, I'm just going to try and see if what these impala were shouting at. There's another elephant there. Rais, the world, of course, every single ecosystem there is made up of hundreds of different habitats, both macro and micro. So in this area that we are, I suppose you might describe the macro habitat as what we call woodland, or broadleafed woodland, but within this one habitat there are thousands of micro habitats. Every little branch that's fallen onto the ground is a micro habitat. Every little hole that's opened, every little piece of dung that's dropped is another micro habitat. Every leaf, inside every leaf. So the reason that life evolves with such incredible diversity is that there is so much to exploit. So the best way to look at it is that life evolves to exploit any niche that can be occupied. And the most simple form of niche, I suppose, would be what we call the trophic niche or the food niche. So the greatest the diversity of life, I suppose, is predicted by the amount that there is to eat. So if you go to the tropics, where there's obviously a huge amount of biodiversity, you'll find even more species, and the further away from the tropics you get, so eventually you get to the Antarctic, you'll find a much lower diversity. I hope that kind of answers your question. Now we're back where we started this drive. There are no impala shouting at the moment. We'll go and do a sort of turn around the other side. Here comes Taksim now. I'll just get out of his way so that he can go down towards the Galago waterhole. But I don't hear no impala alarm calling. Good morning, everyone. Are you behaving? Good. Not. Right, Helen in Birmingham, if you're watching. Hello. Jane and Bernard say hello to you, Helen, in Birmingham. Good. All right, enjoy your drive. That's wonderful. That's really cool. Okay, we'll do a little loop around quarantine and see if we can't find something going on there. They are some impala. They are looking, as David, you know, because David's a very modern fellow, he might say they look chilled to the max. Don't they, Dave? Defs. Totes chilled to the max. Yes, them don't look in the least bit upset about life. Well, let's just see if there aren't any babies amongst them. Could easily have been sort of Tingana sneaking through, slinking on his way to the Galago Pan or going the other way. It's such a peaceful day. Gosh, it's wonderful. You just heard the half-hearted call there of a chin spot batis. Gorgeous. That's interesting. There's an elephant calling there very loudly, and they sometimes do that if they see a predator. Ah, the ubiquitous animal relieving itself as soon as I look at it. Might be a bit of mange on that impala's. In fact, there is on the impala's neck. And just behind his ears. So not only the lions that have struggled with the mange. Now, when you eventually get to the lions with Byron, I cannot get that straight in my head, Byron, when you get there, please will you just make sure that they aren't scratching as much as I thought they weren't. So, I'm of the opinion that they're pretty much over the infection and that they'll start to heal now. But I don't want to have talked too soon. So yesterday, the 7th, I said I hoped there would be an impala lamb. It was a very early estimate. I seem to be wrong, but we'll keep looking. The next, of course, credit is if you failed to predict it, which I have. The next thing is going to be to spot the first one. Okay, let's do a loop around quarantine here. Tax will be going down towards the water there. I'm not sure if Byron has made it to the lions or not, but let's go and find out from him where he is.
So everyone, we're not quite there yet. We've got a glimpse of these lions, but they're on the other side of the drainage line. And I can't seem to get through. I'm driving around at the moment, just trying to get onto another road to see if we can get through that way. I don't know if they moved off from their original position though. And now an elephant roadblock. Have a look at that big tree pushed over. Buffalo again. Now I'm wondering, they seem to be heading in the wrong direction now to where those lions are. I'm not going to stick with these buffalo, everyone. Let's keep going. I want to get to those lions quickly. It's just a bit difficult because of this drainage line, maybe from the other side.
Now, we've got some nyala over here. Sorry about that, Byron. I'm not sure what happened. Just lost a bit of signal. Thankfully, we have still got signal, of course. Beautiful herd of nyalas over here. Four males. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 females. Now, I'm just listening to Aubrey. Now, what I wanted to say, oh yes, a few days ago at Nkoro, somebody sent through a picture of what they thought was a kudu nyala hybrid, but in fact, which is technically possible, I've certainly never seen one, but was in fact one of these young nyalas that had not developed his male coloration. So he was almost fully grown, he had a full set of nyala horns, but he had maintained the coloration of the females. So he was a sort of, I guess you would say, a redhead. And so he'd maintained that colour, and so that was quite unusual. That, if you're wondering what that fence is, everybody, it is the landowner's house, his garden. Quite nice to have a little house out here, David, don't you think? A little spot to come and relax in the wilderness. Now watch carefully what they're eating. And what you will notice, I hope not to be proved wrong here, is that they are not eating grass. They are browsers. They're eating those little forbs, those sort of unidentified herbs coming out of the ground. And I think the nyalas have got through this drought in a far more, than the impala, for example. They don't look very skinny at all. I mean, look, they don't look as fat as they might. But their hips aren't showing at all. But interestingly, I do think that they have suffered probably more than the other antelope from the mange. Definitely seen lots of nyala with mangy looking skin. And then Dave, off to the left, there is a very big nyala bull. He's sort of sitting very regally underneath the marula tree over there. Oh, isn't he wonderful? That is a spectacular animal. Now, I guess his size is quite difficult to tell there, especially as you don't really know what how big that termite mound is. He probably stands about 4.5 to 5 feet at the shoulder. So he's not the biggest antelope, but I think he's by far the most magnificent. Isn't he a majestic fellow? And he's just kind of posturing there. He's got his wives with him. Of course, there are three just to the left of where he is. Chelsea, you were of the opinion that the beard is a good thing and you like their beards. I think their beards are very impressive. The hipsters. See that, David? They're hipsters. They've got those hipster beards. Mm. Like Eggsy. Eggsy, everybody, if you don't know, is a cameraman and editor. And he has got a most impressive beard. He looks a little bit like ZZ Top in his youth. Billy Gibbons, I think his name is. Sorry, that's really got nothing to do with Nyala. Anyway, he's just standing there trying to posture away and show how majestic he is, and he's doing a very good job of it. All right, we'll drive around there and then down towards the Galago Pan. That is where we think the Impala were looking, and Taxon's gone around there. Maybe we'll come up with something. Often what the animals do is, like Tsingdana, for example, will come through that area, or Karula, she does it too. She'll go through that area to the pan and then straight into the hellish block outside of that. And to get in there in a vehicle is just simply impossible. So maybe we'll be lucky, maybe we won't. And we'll just look at the road here and make sure that there aren't any tracks. And just to keep you posted, I'm not sure where Byron is on the reserve, but he's still has no signal at the moment. Maybe there's a Jacobin cuckoo in the middle of that tree there. That's it. There, you got him. No, it's a striped one. Now remember, everybody, there is the Le Valence cuckoo, or striped cuckoo. Now, I was talking about this earlier this morning. The ornithologists, who very much like to confuse the issue, have changed the name of the striped cuckoo, because it is striped, to Le Valence, and that's him. Remember, we saw the Jacobin with no stripes on its breast earlier this morning. Now, while we look at that striped cuckoo, which is looking to do a dastardly deed by planting its egg in someone else's nest, Travis, you're in Virginia and wondering if we ever have the temptation to get involved when an animal is clearly suffering. For example, Taylor was watching that buffalo being killed yesterday. Travis, the answer is yes. I mean, we find it difficult to watch, and certainly I can't stand watching an animal in pain. It's very difficult indeed. But there is an element, of course, and we say this often, that this is nature and we just have to kind of steel ourselves and either look away, and it's not for everybody to watch a kill. I've seen many while I've been out here, and I don't find it pleasant in the slightest when an animal is suffering. But I comfort myself, maybe it's just a psychological thing, saying, you know, once the animal is down, quite often their adrenaline is so strong, or there's so much of it, that they don't actually feel anything, that the amount of pain that they feel is very little. But then you watch a buffalo, like Taylor has done on four or five occasions in the recent past, you watch them take ages to die, you know, and the lions kind of start eating them before they're dead, and that's horrible to watch, but it's been going on for, you know, goodness knows how many millennia, and yeah, it's horrible to see, but David, look over there. But Travis, as horrible as it is, we just have to kind of accept that it happens. For lions would simply not survive as vegans. And who's to say that a carrot or marula fruit has a less right to life than a buffalo? Nice question. Thank you, Travis. I enjoy those little... the sort of delving into the emotional part of being out here, because it is an emotional place. For example, I mean, Travis, if we look at this lilac-breasted Arola, which is what that bird is, I've seen hundreds of them, and if you watch this one for long enough, it will dive down onto the ground and it will grab a grasshopper. Now, the grasshopper, of course, has no way of screaming or making a noise or indicating its pain and suffering, but it does. have no doubt it feels pain, and Louise was just pointing out that it has a termite wing stuck in its beak. Hasn't wiped its mouth, so that termite, in much the same way as the buffalo that was ended by the Nkuhumas yesterday, well, it's passed on. Yes, I suppose a termite is probably less sentient than a buffalo, perhaps. I don't know. And I'll tell you a personal story of shame that shamed me deeply when I was a youngster. I dissected once a what we call a Parkmore prawn, which is a Parkmore or Parktown, depending on where you live in Johannesburg. It's a deeply unpleasant red cricket that lives in Johannesburg, and it's called a king cricket. And if there's anything to terrify the wits out of a city dweller, which of course I was as a youngster, and David will bear me out on this, the king cricket that is the Parkmore prawn in your bed or about to be climb into your shoe was something that terrified you as a child, didn't it, David? And I'll show you a picture of it. But anyway, one day I dissected one, and it wasn't dead. And I'm to this day shamed by my actions. But my father said to me, you know, how can you be so cruel? And I said, but it's a Parkmore prawn. I mean, you know, it's a cricket. We don't like them, surely. I mean, what's the problem? And he very patiently sat down and explained that, and he's no biologist, but he just said, you know, why would you want to be cruel to any creature at all? And I felt immediately, something clicked in me, and I felt immediately very ashamed, of course. And from then on, I've been thinking about these things, as Travis clearly does. Now, I'm just going to find you a picture of this thing, because it really is a beastly-looking, terrifying creature. It's a king cricket, with just as much right to life, of course, as anything else. There it is. There it is there. It grows to about, the big ones, I guess, about 3 inches long. So, I mean, they get to about that big. And they push out this disgusting, stinking black stuff if you threaten them. There we are, the magnificent king cricket. And that is a vestigial shudder from my childhood. Okay, let's move on. Right, Byron has managed to fix his car. He's managed to find something that he went out to look for early this morning. Let's go and have a look.
Finally, we managed to find the lines, everyone, or get in here. It was a bit tricky, and we did lose signal there for a while, but look at this. They're still feeding on the buffalo, and there's very little left there. Have a look at that. And just as I was saying to you earlier this morning, I wonder how much of this buffalo will be left, because these lions, there are a lot of mouths to feed you at the moment, so all five lionesses, 1, 2, 3, 4... all five lionesses, and it appears as if all 8 cubs are around here. So it's a lot of mouths to feed, which is, you know, and that's why they get through these buffalo so quickly. I don't see any sign of a male, so perhaps the males did not meet up with these females last night. Which is a good thing, because then there would have been even more mouths to feed, and the males can feed on a lot of meat. And look at them, they're just relaxing now, resting. Justin, you want to know how long will it take a leopard or a lion to learn how to stalk properly or sneak down on the ground close to their prey? Well, Justin, I would say usually for leopards it's probably a bit earlier, so maybe a year and a half.
before they really start hunting on their own and become independent. For lions, it might be a bit later. It may be somewhere along the lines of 2 to 2.5 years before they start understanding it properly and learning how to hunt properly. But they will be watching their mothers from before that. But I would say around 2 years, 2.5 years. And if when you watch these lion cubs playing, they do stalk and they sneak up on one another. All of that is a learning experience for these young cubs, and that is how they learn to stalk and sneak up on prey. Okay, there's that. Anna, you were saying our cat streak continues. It does indeed. We're very, very fortunate, everyone. And there's going to come a day, and we must remember this, there will probably be a day where we don't see the lions. We don't find a big cat, and that's the way of the bush. It does happen at times. Oh, lioness is getting a bit aggressive with one another at the carcass. Did you hear that, everyone? Wow. Just trying to listen to all the sounds, everyone. Listen carefully. Oh, look at that little cub. Looks like he's got a rib there. Ripple. Nice big bone that he can chew on. Every now and then you can hear these lionesses crunching on the bones. They've got very powerful jaws. Wow, look at that power. Don't know where she's wanting to take that carcass now. See, I think what's happened here, everybody, is this lioness is possibly just trying to move it further under the tree. And one of the reasons they do that is to keep it out of sight of vultures, which may attract other predators like hyena. So that's usually why they try and drag it right under a tree to hide the carcass a little bit. And I think it was Katya that wanted to know, do these lions ever get food poisoning from eating meat that isn't fresh? No, not that I've seen. And I've seen lions feed on carcasses 2 or 3 days old. So, no, I don't think so. Listen carefully, everybody. The other lioness is calling. Listen. She's giving quite a few calls now. I don't know why she is doing that, everyone. I have no idea, because the whole pride is here. on, Scoots, and you say that it would be great if these lions caught a bigger buffalo today. And would be great indeed. And as we saw driving in, everyone, while you were with us earlier, there's a lot of buffalo around here. So definitely is a chance of that happening. Really peaceful sitting here because it's a lovely cool morning. These lions are just moving around feeding. Look at those little cubs feeding there. So funny to watch these lionesses get a little bit upset with these cubs. They get too close. This little cub just got a warning too, that one that you can see over there. Female did growl at him when he got, or him or her. When it got a bit closer, flies are bothering it. Wow, this lioness really is dragging his carcass deep into the, or under that tree. Wonderful to hear the sounds, everyone. Every now and then you get these cubs calling, making these strange little sounds. It's all contact calling within the pride. I don't know why that other lioness was calling though. That is very interesting. I mean, if anything, it could possibly be that she's checking if there are males in the area. Chewing on that bone, and that also strengthens their teeth, everyone, so it's important that they chew on these bones and chew on some of that meat. See that little cub's licking that bone, and they do have, I mean, even at that age their tongues will be very rough, so it's possibly licking a bit of meat off of them. You know, we've been speaking about it now for the last 2 weeks, or almost 3 weeks, especially since I've been here. I've noticed that how successful these lions have been with hunting the buffalo. They have hunted a number of buffalo in the last few weeks. And I think, again, you know, we've mentioned it, it's because they the buffalo have not been really healthy. There's been very little food coming out of the drought and the winter. That one doesn't want to share anymore. So the buffalo being weakened have made it easier prey for the lions to hunt. And that, I think, is one of the main reasons why they've been so successful hunting buffalo. And also it's a large pride, so they need a lot of food to feed all the cubs and the lionesses. So buffalo is a perfect kill for them. And Katy, again, you wanted to know if these lions ever dig a hole when they do defecate, just like house cats, and bury the dung. No, they do not. Or bury their feces. They do not. They'll just they'll squat out. Usually what they do, though, which is quite interesting, they'll walk a little bit away from the pride, and then they'll defecate and drop their feces and then just move off again. They don't cover it like house cats. Ryan, you want to know how old the cubs are, and I think they're almost 9 months old, if I'm not mistaken. I think they're 8 going on 9 months. It's a lot of activity here at the moment, everyone. I think because it's nice and cool, these cubs are playing a little bit. They're trying to chew on some of the meat. Lionesses are moving backwards and forwards. It's wonderful. It really is wonderful. And you can see most of these cubs, their bellies are quite full. Look at that. A little cub jumped right over the carcass. So the bellies are full. Oof, getting a bit of a whiff of that carcass now. It's a bit strong. Got a pungent smell. So some full bellies around here, which is good. Daniel, you want to know how long a lion can live for. So, Daniel, it all depends on the area. Sorry, I thought I heard something. So, Daniel, it does all depend on the area, how much competition is around, how much food, how much water. But on average, lionesses, so the female lions, will live to the age of about 14, 15 years old. That's an average. And then male lions between 10 and 12 years old. So not as long as the lionesses. But again, like I said, that's an average and it can change at times. If you've got a very successful pride, if there are a lot of lions hunting and they're providing food for the whole pride regularly, then you could very possibly have these lionesses and males live a lot longer. Also, coalitions of males, where you get three or four big dominant males together and they patrol an area. With them being together, they probably won't have to fight as much and defend their territory as much because they'll keep other lions out. So then they may also live a little bit longer. But that's the average, about 14 to 15 years for females and about 10 to 12 years for males. Oh, look at these cubs playing in the foreground here. Wow, they get very upset with one another when they're trying to play. Yeah, the growls. See those little cubs having a go at each other. Wow. They get very aggressive. That's young age. Interesting. And whenever there's food around, it's amazing to see how aggressive these lions can be. Melinda, you wanted to know how long these lions can go for without food. So I've seen lions go 3 or 4 days without eating anything. But then you can see they start looking really, really hungry. So I would say that's pushing it. They do try and hunt at least once every 2 to 3 days. Even though, after this buffalo, they could probably easily go 3 days without food. But the thing is, they don't want to. They're opportunistic. If the food is around and they're able to hunt, they will hunt. They don't want to get to the stage where they are hungry. Kathy, you'd be surprised at how effective the lionesses are when hunting, when their bellies are so full. And even though they do look lethargic and a little bit slower, they will still move very, very quickly and they will still be able to hunt on a full belly. I just hear another vehicle coming, everybody, so I might have to reposition our vehicle just to make space for them. Just trying to look for a little gap for us. I think, if you don't mind, I'm just going to reposition quickly, just so that there is space for the other vehicle. So we want as many people as possible to see these lions and enjoy the sighting with us. And luckily for us, we've got the camera, so we can position just about anywhere, so you can still enjoy the sighting with us. Tina, all the way from Canada. Good evening to you, Tina, or good morning from South Africa. Tina, you want to know, is there a hierarchy between the females? There may be a slight hierarchy, but generally, Tina, what happens when they are feeding like this, or when they're hunting, they work together as a pride. So each one has got a role, and they know that they need to work together to be able to hunt a buffalo. And when they are feeding, usually they all feed together, so you won't necessarily see that hierarchy when they're feeding, because these females rely so much on each other. There may be a slight hierarchy within the pride. One female is probably a bit more dominant, and usually what happens is it may be the oldest female. And I mean, what I've seen in a few different prides before, where there's an adult lioness that has given birth to cubs, those cubs have grown up within the pride. So you've got a female that's about 3 years older than the next lionesses. And then that would usually be a more dominant female. She'd most likely ensure the safety of the pride and make sure they move through the correct areas and know where to hunt and so on. But it's sometimes difficult for us to see, and we might not pick up on it unless you know which lioness is which. But generally, the older lioness may be a bit more dominant. Listen to the growls, everyone. And again, these little cubs get very aggressive when they're feeding. And lions do in general with each other. It's survival of the fittest. When there's food around, they all want the best piece of meat. Listen to those little growls. It's amazing the sound that these little cubs can make, though. We're going to sit with these lions a little bit longer to see what they get up to, if they do decide to move after feeding on this kill. While I do that, let's head back to James, everyone. Let's see what he is up to. I believe he's making his way towards Cheetah Plains.
Byron's now spoiled my surprise. Of course, I was going to tell you that I'm going to Cheetah Plains. Now you know already. Anyway. There is a giraffe, everybody. And this is just before we go through that bad signal spot on the way to Cheetah Plains. So we stopped at a giraffe. I think we saw him yesterday. He's a very dark giraffe, of course, and that makes him, well, not necessarily older than some, but he's certainly a big, mature bull. And that's definitely the old boy we saw yesterday. He is quite old. You can see he's got lots of calcified knobs on his head. Let me just train my binoculars on him. Yes. What you seen, David? David just went, ugh, everyone, and I thought he'd spotted Karula or something. But he hasn't. You found a water buck. Well done, David. There we are. Water buck bull. Astoundingly, actually, by some water, which I find increasingly seldom these days. I'm beginning to think that water buck is simply the wrong name for them. He's got some magnificent set of horns there. And all around you can hear the industrious call of the red-billed buffalo weaver. Now they do an enormous amount of building. If we go up towards there, it seems that they build just about all year round. And poor old Connor's had to go up onto our mast where we've got a number of complicated bits of technology. But on the mast, the red-billed buffaloes build incessantly. So every time you want to go up there, you have to break the nest down. And so you'll get yourself covered in mites and gnats and bird dung and all sorts of horrible things. But they build and build and build. And even though we're into the summer now, here comes one now. With a stick. There he goes. He's got himself a nice stick. And he just kind of add it in there. Here he is. His wife's telling him that she doesn't really like that piece of furniture and that perhaps he should go back. But he said, no, no, I think we'll put it in here. How he decides where he's going to put that stick, I couldn't begin to tell you. Anyway, we're going to head across to Cheetah Plains now and we'll see what we can find there. There were reports of quarantine and that's why we're sort of thinking about heading across there. Aye, Minjan. That's Abel. All right, Byron's still with the Lions. Let's head over to them and I will see you then next on Cheetah Plains, hopefully with some good news.
So sorry for spoiling your surprise, James. I didn't know you wanted it to be a surprise. Good luck out there. I hope you do manage to find that quarantine mail. These lions are still feeding bits and pieces, little cubs. Still getting very aggressive with each other. Oh, listen to them. Elaine, you want to know if the lionesses will hurt the cubs while they're feeding? The lionesses are careful, but they do still get quite aggressive when they're feeding. And I've seen it a few times where these lionesses smack a cub if it gets too close or tries to get in her way while she's feeding. I give them a little bit of a paw just to put them back in line. And I have seen, definitely seen lionesses, but they... It's funny, their motherly instinct kicks in and then they know they generally hold back a little bit, if that makes sense, but they do indeed warn the little cubs if they do get in the way. That's interesting. I can just see, I don't know if you can see, it's behind the tree and she's just stopped now. But one of the lionesses walked over to where the carcass was originally and she started to kick sand up into that area. And they do that to try and mask the smell of this carcass, so hopefully as to not attract any other predators, like hyena.
a few flies buzzing around, as you can imagine, around this carcass. It's just wonderful to be able to sit and enjoy the sighting. To the right, this lioness and this cub. She went to go investigate what that little cub has got. Oh, she's moving. Thought she's going to come and lie close to us and get an investigator. Look at that little cub, doesn't want to share with its mother. Oh, that's wonderful. Look at that. You know, for such large beasts that can be quite aggressive and very powerful hunters, you know, they are still very affectionate towards each other. You saw that lioness licking and cleaning the cub. Just that instinct of motherly love, which is, it's wonderful to see. Just heard some branches breaking in the distance, everyone. Probably those elephants that we saw earlier. Atif, you wanted to know, or you mentioned that there's no male lion around at the moment. And what happens if another male lion comes in and tries to take over this pride? So Atif, in this area, we have got a coalition of males. Four males, known as the Birmingham males. That's the what we refer to this coalition as. And Atif, they do not belong to a specific pride. And these males have a very large territory, so they are able to keep out other males and challenge them for territory, for more territory, so they can extend and expand their territory. So what these males do is they will meet up with females from a few different prides, not just one. They do not only spend their time with one pride. Now, we've been lucky in the last few weeks, week or two, there has been one or two of these males within the pride every now and then. They're following the females around and seeing if they're ready to mate. So Atif, what happens now is, even though the males are not here, they are still patrolling the territory. And by doing that, they are keeping out any other lions that would want to come into the area. So the thing we need to remember is that these big males do protect the pride that way. Because if males had to come in that, you know, from a different area, those males would probably attack these cubs and potentially try and kill them. The reason for that is then they would hopefully force the females to come into estrus, or force the females to mate with them, and so that these females may give birth to their offspring. But luckily, with these four big males, dominant males around, I think this entire pride is quite safe at the moment. So as I was saying, Atif, this one male does not belong to this pride only. They will move between the different prides, and they do meet up with the prides at times. But they do not belong to this pride. And just a Comes spinning around there. Just a big hello to everybody watching on Twitter's Periscope. And we know we're streaming live there now, so it's great that you can join us on that platform. Something different, something new. So it's wonderful to have all you viewers watching via that platform. It's exciting, isn't it?
I hope you're enjoying it with us.
Big Blue, you've noticed something very interesting, and we can see those cubs doing it there now. You said, do these lions put their ears back when feeding because they are worried they get bitten? No. So Big Blue, what's happening there is those cubs are getting aggressive. Look at that one. You see that face? It's getting aggressive, and what they do is they pin their ears back. That's an agonistic behavior, that aggressive behavior. We spoke about it the other day. And what it is those black spots on the ears and that, with them flattening the ears and pushing them back, it is a sign of aggression. And that is why they do it. So there you can see it's growling and snarling, the ears are flattened, pushed back. It's a sign of anger, it's a sign of aggression. That's why they're doing it. But well spotted. It's interesting to see that with the young cubs while they're feeding. Zoe, you wanted to know if I've ever seen these lions or any big cat. Listen to that, everyone. Lions or leopards or any big cats trying to get something out of a pond or a pan or a dam. I'm just trying to think now, Zoe. I haven't seen it myself, well, to an extent, and I'll show you a picture shortly, but I haven't actually seen lions or leopards trying to catch catfish, myself, but I've seen documentaries where they do it, and they will definitely do it if they come across a drying up water hole or pan. They will definitely go in and try and catch some of these catfish, especially leopards. Have I ever seen lions actually go into a pan where a giraffe had drowned and the lions climbed into the water and onto the giraffe to feed? And I'll actually show you a picture of it just to, just so you can see what it looked like. It was a sighting not too long ago, and it just shows you how these lions will literally climb into the water if they want to see or if they need to get to food. And if you have a look here, is just a picture I took of this male lion. Look at that, feeding on a giraffe and completely in the water hole. Isn't that incredible? So this I took this, I think it was in August. So this giraffe, old giraffe, and we spoke about it earlier,
What would cause older animals to die, and this old giraffe came down and drank and actually slipped, fell into the waterhole and couldn't get up again. It was just old, weakened, and it drowned, and these male lions eventually found it and fed on it. But the way, I mean, just to show you how opportunistic they are, they climbed into the water, walked in, and started to feed. And they were there for about 2 or 3 days, because it was a massive kill, big giraffe, and it was just the two males. No other lions came and fed on it, so they were there for quite some time. Some cubs playing over there. A lot of sounds, everybody. Can you hear that? Look at those cubs rubbing up against the females. Wonderful interaction. But these cubs are very vocal this morning, which is great. Lovely to hear them making their little sounds. And very different to that growling when they are feeding. There comes a little cub. Oh dear, what's wrong? Where are you running off to? Perhaps a little bit nervous of the vehicle moving around. Just watching closely. Interesting question, Crystal. You wanted to know if the lions will kill more often as the cubs get older. Crystal, most likely, you know, when as the cubs get older, obviously they need more food. So in saying that, then they probably have to kill quite regularly. And to feed a whole pride of, you know, 5 females, 8 cubs, 13 lions. It's a lot of lions to feed, a lot of mouths to feed. So they may indeed hunt more frequently. But the other thing is, I mean, we've been lucky to see them the last 2-3 weeks being very successful hunting buffalo. It's not always like that, everyone. It really isn't. The lions are not always that successful when it comes to hunting. Generally, an average with lion success is they only have about a 30% success rate from all the hunts. I know a lot of us watch these documentaries on National Geographic and so on, and we see these lion hunts and kills on a regular basis, and we've been lucky to show you some of that live on Safari Now. But it doesn't always happen like that. You know, a lot of those documentaries, people spend hours out there watching, following, spending time with these animals and trying to get them hunting. but they're not always that successful. It's difficult for lions to hunt because all these other animals are so aware and so alert of what's going on around them. I just think because at the moment the buffalo are weak and there's a lot of buffalo around, that the lions have been more successful. But when they get older, these cubs, the lions would still try and hunt, so probably just as frequently as they are doing now.
as I mentioned again, they're very opportunistic. So if food is around, they will hunt. But they will need more meat to feed these cubs when they are older. So probably hunt a lot more and a lot more frequently when they do get older. So I was starting to worry about James. I thought he got lost because I hadn't heard from him for quite a while. But he apparently has a surprise on Cheetah Plains for you. So let's go see what that is.
We have the biggest marula tree on Cheetah Plains here, and I thought that you'd love to see that. Oh, David, what's that? It looks like your favorite leopard. Everybody, that is the famous Quarantine, son of Karula the Queen, ergo one of the princes. There are many princes, of course. And I think he's a magnificent fellow, and he is David's very favorite animal in the world. David, why is he your favorite animal? You just like him. You like his vibe, do you? He is very splendid indeed. He is also very tired. Now, I don't know. We just got here right now, so I don't know if there's something dead in the tree that is making him so full and sleepy here, but I don't think so, because he came, I think, from Three in a Row Pan, climbed into this tree and went to sleep. And this leopard, I think quite unusually, likes to sleep in trees even if he doesn't have a kill. He's often found just sort of lying up in a tree. Oh, that is a quintessential leopard shot, isn't it? I'm just going to move out the way quickly for Andrew. There we go. David, I think the leopard is better looking than I am. All he was doing is leveling the camera, everybody. Oh, okay. Ntawuma switch. I just have to move quickly. Taj, Andrew's just reminded me that I'm trespassing slightly and I'll be in trouble if I get seen. So I'm just going to move out the way. It's fine. Taj, you are watching, believe it or not, on Periscope, which of course is Twitter's live video feed, and you say you want to know whether this is live or not. Taj, it's Periscope. Of course it's live. And of course the very fact that I have mentioned your name just after you've asked the question indicates that we are completely live in Africa on the western fringes of the Kruger Park with a leopard. And the leopard is very much alive, Taj. You can see it breathing there. It has not been placed there. It is real. And he's a 4-year-old male leopard coming up on his 4th birthday next month. It was a Christmas baby. His mother, Karula, one of our favorite characters. She's 12 years old, almost 13 now. She's got two other little cubs at the moment. They're now 9 months old. And he was part of her 4th litter. He and his brother were number 7 and 8. Now, Teresa, you and various others have said to me, do I see the sterling pound note sign on his left brow? And I've got to tell you, I've stared long and hard at his left brow. I've just seen it. Okay. Thank you, Teresa. I've got it now. Everyone, if you look above his left eye, most of you know this, of course, there is a pound note, and sort of the spots make up a pound sign, and I've only just managed to see it now. Thank you, Teresa. I've stared at this leopard for hours, but now I've managed to see it. There it is. Excellent. Thank you, Teresa. So we'll sit here for a little while, and then we'll press on and see what else Cheat to Plains has to offer. But let's just spend a bit of time with him. I know he's not doing flick-flacks or swinging from branch to branch, but it is just so very quintessential to sit with the male leopard in a tree in Africa, live, of course, from the African wild. So if you're watching on Periscope, well, be not in doubt. All right, now those lions are insatiable. They're hungry again. Let's head across to them. They seem to be about to go for another buffalo.
Okay, everyone, something has just materialized over here. These lionesses have spotted some buffalo moving not too far away. You can, actually, I don't know if you'd be able to see them. You might be able to. There they are. Can you see that? They're the buffalo. So not too far, and these lionesses are all fixed and focused on them at the moment. It looks as if they may try and flank them a little bit. Now, this could just happen very quickly, and we've spoken about how opportunistic these lions are, and this could get very, very exciting very quickly. And just a reminder, everybody, that this is live, and these is wild, so for sensitive viewers, if you are not wanting to see a hunt, it might be a good time to go and make a cup of tea if you do not want to see it. I'm not saying they're definitely going to be successful, but there is a good chance. So let's see what happens. Wow, this is exciting. Very, very exciting. We don't want to move around too much because we don't want to disturb them. And it looks like those buffalo are heading in this direction. So what I assume might happen is these lionesses might lie down and wait for the buffalo to move a bit closer so that they don't have to stalk. They can just lie in ambush. And what might happen is then, as they get a bit closer, rush out and try and get one of these buffalo. It's very exciting. Let's see what happens. Oh, I can see. Here comes an elephant too, moving through there. That could definitely change things slightly, because elephants often chase lions if they do smell them or see them. But watch, all these lionesses now are completely fixated on these buffalo. 1, 2, 3, 4. Where's the other lioness? I just see 4 of them at the moment. But it's incredible how the whole atmosphere around here has just changed. Oh, this is interesting, but those are some big males. You can see just by the boss, middle section of horn, the boss, it's very thick. So these do look like bigger males, bigger than this buffalo that they did kill. And these little cubs are calling around us, making a bit of noise. Isn't that a wonderful shot that Brian has got there with the lioness and the buffalo in the background? Ah, oh, it's wonderful. That is really great. The elephants seem to be moving away. it's actually hard to see. You can't see the elephants now. They're about 60 meters or so away, 60 to 70 meters. And it looks like they're moving away from me. I can just see the ears moving through, but let's stay with this lioness and buffalo, because look how fascinating this is. Watch us stalking, everyone. And as I mentioned, well, you can see the two lionesses now lying there. I think the other one is just behind those bushes. So lying, waiting, not stalking any closer, just seeing if these buffalo actually approach them and they can ambush them. It'd be much easier than trying to stalk. This is very exciting, everyone, and the thing is that we don't know when this is going to explode. It could happen any time from now or 10, 15 minutes from now. But let's have a look. Buffalo coming closer. Brian was saying he thinks this buffalo heard the cub, and that's a possibility. Heard the sound of the little cubs making a noise. So hopefully the cubs don't spoil it for the lionesses. Michael, you asked, do the cubs know to sit still and be quiet? It does appear as if they do know. They're not walking over to the females and bothering them. They are hanging back. They're lying down where they were left, but they are making little sounds, which is not ideal. They need to be quieter. But it is incredible to see how they know to hang back a little bit. They're not right next to the females or moving around or playing as much as they were earlier. So that instinct does kick in, and they can see the change in body language from the lionesses, as you can see there, that lion poised and ready. Flying Fish, you asked, are buffalo colorblind? Now I'm trying to think, I always forget this, I wonder how they study it. Apparently, judging by the rods and cones in their eyes, they can determine what animals see, and they usually say, you know, predators generally see in a black and white color, but I don't know about antelope and buffalo and that. I'm actually not sure what their eyesight is like, if it is color. I would assume it's a bit of color though. And again, I always wonder how accurate those studies are, but you know, nowadays modern medicine and the studies and the research that gets done, it is really incredible. These cubs are starting to move a bit closer, everyone, which is a bit worrying, because they may mess up this hunt or potential hunt or spoil it if they make too much noise, move around too much. Those buffalo are still slowly creeping forward. Again, I don't want to move too much now. Don't want to disturb the lionesses or the buffalo. We don't want to favor either of the two. But look at that. Oh, that buffalo is getting much closer. If these lionesses do spring up and run off the buffalo, we will move quite quickly. Now that female is buffalo over there is not looking too healthy at the moment. You can see the ribs And I say it's a female. You can see the boss, very, very thin horn structure, not as thick as the males around her. So something like that could potentially be a bit easier to hunt everyone, because she looks a little bit weaker. So let's see what happens. These little cubs better sit tight. Wow, that's amazing. Look at that, everyone. Now, as I mentioned, oh, hang on. These lions have kind of flanked these buffalo a little bit. They spread out. They're probably about 40 meters apart. From the lioness on the far left to the lioness on the far right. So they've kind of flanked them, and what may happen is one could possibly burst out and maybe try and chase one buffalo towards the other lionesses. Okay, it's starting to get quite tense here again, everyone. These buffalo are even closer now. That. I think the buffalo. Yeah, there we go. Move, everyone, let's try to see. It looks like they managed to not quite get one yet, but they were following one. The elephant are trumpeting. There we go. There's the lioness on the back, everyone. Look at that, look at that. There we go. The elephants have trumpeted. They're moving off. Look at this. Yes. This is incredible, everyone. Just again, everybody, for those sensitive viewers, if you are watching, it's not always easy to see, but this is nature, everybody. So just bear that in mind, please. And this is interesting. Let's just watch. Five lionesses now. Watch how they'll try and keep that buffalo busy while that one lioness is hanging on. She won't let go, but look how strong this. Look at that. Try and get the legs out from under the buffalo. And how powerful is that buffalo, though, to be able to stand with this lioness on its back. Other buffalo may also come back and help this one. There's some elephant coming into the area now too. Let's see what happens. Wow, this is... Oh. Look at that. Managed to shake off that lioness and get away. Now with this elephant just off to the right, you might see it coming into frame. There we go. Let's see what happens here. Oh, you see the lionesses moving off very quickly. I don't like the elephant very much. Wow. Look at that. Isn't that incredible? buffalo managed to get away and the elephants chased the lions off. You see, lions do not really like big elephant. I'm just going to watch what this elephant does. No, easy. I'm not going to move. She's just chasing that other lioness. Don't charge us. Hey, don't worry. See, I don't want to move. No, hang on. We're not here to hurt you. See, I don't want to make too many loud noises and sounds like this other cat is doing. See, they're a little bit upset with these lions around. This is just a young elephant there. Just want to sit tight. So everyone, see, this is typical behavior. These animals do get very upset when there are lions around and that, but I do think staying calm as much as possible is far better than trying to make too much noise, shouting at the elephant. Try to keep our voices as calm as possible. I do believe they pick up on that. And that young elephant could see just coming towards us and then moved off again. Just unhappy with all these lions around. And there it goes. Some more elephant running, and there's buffalo running off to our left. Possibly smelt. Now, situations like this, everyone, you do have to be sure to have an escape route just in case, especially with a herd of elephant around like this. And with that other one trumpeting, it will definitely alert the herd. And you saw some buffalo running there too. I don't know where the lions have gone. Now, one lioness headed back in that direction. So it's all going on at the moment. It really is. I mean, this is incredible. Isn't that amazing? And that elephant did get my blood pumping a little bit. But like I said, it's best to stay calm and just try and assess the situation as best as possible. Not panic, not make too much noise. Just see, and if you need to, then you can react and possibly make a loud noise, which would probably stop the elephant. But luckily there, it didn't look like it was really aggressive, just wanted to warn us and try to chase us away too. And I think purely because it got hyped up by those lions being around here. How amazing was that? That was incredible. So exciting. Wow, they've got goosebumps, everyone. That was incredible. There's still some elephant moving off through the thicket. You can't really see them now, but I'm just wanting to explain the scenario a little bit better. So there's still a few elephant dotted around. Some buffalo moved around again. Looks like most of the lionesses headed back towards the rest of the cubs. And so we'll move around and head back there shortly. But it's interesting to see how that behavior, and that's why the buffalo calling like that distress call alerted the elephant. The elephant came back, the other buffalo came back too, and it's incredible to see once those lions get outnumbered or these big animals start chasing them, they're very nervous and they'll get out of there very quickly. That buffalo was lucky though to be able to shake that lioness off, and with that elephant coming in. And I always say this, with seeing that elephant move in and those lions run off, who is the king of the jungle? And I think it might be the elephant, everyone, because that one elephant just came in and basically saved the buffalo, I think, and chased the lions off. What a fascinating sighting. Yeah, that is incredible. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to head back and let's go see where those lions are, if they've moved back to where the cubs were. And see, I can't see them just yet. dropped off a little bit. When a travel on off. Laughing at the other ranger. There's still that young elephant over there, straight ahead, everybody, and it possibly sees or smells the lions. That's where the lions were. I think these lions have, what's the best way to describe it, high-tailed it out of here. Yeah, there they go. They're running off to the right. Can you see them down there, Brian? There, I've just spotted them. There they go. That elephant is not happy with them. Also, I think, everyone, I'm not going to go too much closer because I don't want to aggravate that elephant anymore. There's no need for that. And again, remember, we need to be sensitive. And something like this puts all these animals on edge. And to avoid situations, you do give them a bit of space. There's no need for us to go closer. I think it is important that everybody realizes that this really was an incredible, incredible sighting in terms of interaction and between three different species, three of the big five, and the apex predator of the area, and then the two largest herbivores around here. Well, the buffalo, I suppose, probably the third or fourth largest. If you take into consideration the rhino and the hippopotamus. In a second, I might get us a better view from this side. Oh dear, this vehicle. Let's have a look. I might get a view from here, but like I said, everybody, that was great to see. Maggie from Ohio, and let's just have a look. Those lions are straight down there. Can you see them? Maggie from Ohio, you wanted to know, did this elephant specifically come back to save the buffalo? What was its motivation? No, Maggie, I don't think so. I'll tell you why I say that, everyone. Is these elephant moved into the area. So we first heard the elephant coming through, and then we saw the buffalo. Those distress calls from the buffalo basically got the rest of the herd to come back and try and help. I mean, we could see them in the background. The thing is, that distress call, and that does now work up the elephant and gets the elephant's attention. Now, this elephant, it was actually a herd of elephant around here. So now we've got a herd of elephant, and they are very protective over one another. And because there is a predator around, the elephant don't necessarily know, are these lions just hunting the buffalo? Are the lions going to go for the buffalo and for one of the elephant? So my theory, and I say this is a theory because there's never a guaranteed answer or completely correct answer in a situation like this. My theory is that these elephants were aggravated by the sounds, the smells of the lions, and the buffalo distress call. All of that put these elephants on edge, and now what they're going to do is they're going to protect themselves. They want to get rid of these predators. So all that elephant did was come through, trumpet, charge. The rest of the herd was then very wary of the lions around. They moved a little bit closer together. We saw they were in the background. Some of the other elephant have come into the area now too to investigate. So I don't think it was necessarily a case of the elephant knowing that it is coming to save the buffalo. Because if we think back, the lioness was on that buffalo quite some time. So, you know, I think it's purely a case of the elephant were protecting their own herd and themselves and just purely trying to get rid of a predator. Even when lions aren't hunting, if lions are sleeping in the shade of a tree and elephants walk by, if they smell them or see them, they'll come straight back and they'll chase them away. I've seen it many times, purely because they are predators. They don't want them around. So I think that's what happened in that situation. These elephants seem to have calmed down now a little bit. The lions have moved off. I can just still see some movement through the thicket. It's very difficult to see them. But wasn't that incredible interaction? To see it all unfold in front of us, these buffalo moving closer towards the lions not stalking necessarily, but just lying in ambush. And as soon as those buffalo got close enough, off they went, and they tried to catch one. And that lioness did very well, I think, to be able to jump on the back of that buffalo. And we saw how powerful that lioness was holding on. And that's a good 140, 150 kilograms. So what's that, about 340 pounds, somewhere around there, I would say. 320, 340 pounds of muscle on your back. And this buffalo, that female buffalo, managed to stand her ground, turn around, chase off the other lions. You saw she used her horns. She kept facing them, trying to chase them off, and managed to shake off that other lioness, which was incredible. Just shows you how powerful these buffalo actually are. There we can see some movement through the thicket. There goes the lionesses. Marianne from Arkansas, the cubs I did see moved with those lionesses. The lionesses just ran back towards the cubs, took the cubs away from this area. These elephants are all feeding in and around that area where the carcass was of the buffalo that they were feeding on. So the lionesses did just take all of them down towards the drainage line. I'm not sure how we're going to get down there. It looks very thick, as you can see. But they did fetch the cubs and take them away. You can see the elephant off to our left, still feeding. Ralph the dog, you wanted to know, will the buffalo survive those wounds that were inflicted on it by the elephant now? Yes, definitely. I think all that it got was a few scratches on the back and a bite or two on the back, on the spine and that, but it didn't look like it caused too much damage. And these animals all have an amazing ability to heal very, very well. And often you'll find buffalo with scars, not just buffalo, zebra, you'll find them, and some other animals, larger animals, you'll find them with scars from lions and that, but they've managed to get away and eventually they will heal. And that buffalo looked fine when it did move off. Obviously a lot of adrenaline going through it, but I mean, you could see how powerful it was to turn around and shake off that lioness. What an amazing sighting, everybody. That was very, very special. It's not something you see every day. So, and we were speaking about it earlier when I said, you know, these lions are not always successful when they hunt. And we've just seen that. They will try and try and try, and every now and then they are lucky and they do pull a buffalo down. These buffalo are powerful, and we just saw now how the herd works together, and one or two of the buffalo came back to try and help. But I think also luckily the elephant were around here to chase the lions off and so that the buffalo could get away. fascinating behavior. It does not get much better than that, everyone, that's for sure. Just trying to see, let's just have a quick look around here. See if I can see which direction those lions have gone. It looks like they moved up this drainage line. But like I said, everyone, you know, and you see, I'd like to stress this because I think it's important. You see these videos on YouTube of people being charged and chased by elephant and panicking a little bit or not listening to warning signs and that and not understanding the elephant behavior. I'm not saying I'm an expert at all, but I do think that spending a lot more time out here does enable you to understand their behavior a bit better. And that situation, I just didn't feel the need to have to start the vehicle, rev it, make a loud noise and race away. And it's strange, and I don't know, it's just a feeling that you get sometimes when dealing with some of these animals. I am always very, very careful and very wary of elephant. Look at the herd off to our right, everyone. Look how they're all standing. And that is because I think of all this commotion, they're protecting the youngsters. See how they're standing close by the mothers. They can obviously sense that the lions are potentially still in this area. So they're staying close by just in case, just to make sure.
Debbie, you wanted to know if one of these Birmingham males, one of the big coalition males, if he was with the Pride, would there have been a different outcome? It's hard to say, Debbie. I think because of these elephant in it that came through, I think the outcome in the end would have been the same. But perhaps the Lions would have been able to get that buffalo down, because with a big, powerful male around, they usually help a lot with buffalo kills. And he would have most likely been able to take that buffalo down. So it could have resulted in the buffalo being taken down, but I think in the end, with these elephant around, I think it would have been the same outcome. Now, everybody, I'm just watching these elephant behavior and listening to them. I'm actually going to leave them, and I'll tell you why. They do seem a little bit distressed still, and I don't want to disturb them any further or cause them to react. Remember, I just said the whole thing is being sensitive, understanding the behavior. There's no need to try and move closer. We've seen them now, we know where they are, but you can see they are distressed. They've got the little ones close to them, and I'd prefer just to leave them alone, because I think even though they seem relaxed, but again, you don't want to take a chance, and there's no need to. So I'm going to leave them alone. They're not reacting to us in any way, but like I said, it's always better to be safer than sorry. See if we can get back out of this area. But let's still see where the rest of these other elephants are. James, you want to know if the Lions would track the blood trail of that buffalo? James, I'm not sure. Potentially, but the thing is, I didn't see too much blood coming off of that buffalo. I don't know if some of the viewers got to see more. I mean, I could see some of the scratch wounds, but to see the actual blood trail or to follow it, it may happen, James. It may happen. It's not. I'm not ruling it out completely, but I don't think so. I think those lions are a little bit upset now that they missed their kill. See, these elephants are still here, and I'm just going to see. Was this a young one? I think that was making all the noise earlier. And the reason why I'm giving them space now is because that carcass is just behind them. So this elephant can definitely smell it. And I don't want to. No, they seem fine. Anyway, again, it's a case of, I think, just trying to stay calm in a situation. Don't try and aggravate the animals even more. So there, you know, just a slow, soft, calm voice. Who knows? I mean, like I say, I don't know if it, I'm not saying I'm an elephant expert at all, but I do think that the more time you spend with these animals, you do understand their behavior a bit better. And again, just trying to be sensitive and trying to keep a bit of space. That elephant came towards us, but I just didn't feel like it was necessarily going to charge and hit the vehicle or anything. And there's still, this little one is giving us some warnings over here. That's great. Anyway, I've moved off a little bit so we can squeeze through here now. Beard, you wanted to know why don't prey animals hang out with elephants more often? That's a good idea, because as you can see, it's quite nice when you've got some elephant around. Wow, that was incredible. Very, very exciting. I'm so glad you got to watch all of that with us from the beginning and to see what happened. Just trying to see if I can see where these lions have gone, everybody. I can't see. Let's just have a look. Stay with us a little bit. Oh, these brakes, everybody. Sure. Let's just see if we can see where they've gone. Dana, you want me to do an impression of the squeaky brakes? No, sorry, Dana, not just yet. I don't think that would be very wise. Let's just have a look here, everybody. Let's see if we can find out where these lines have gone. Very upset and moved off very quickly. They did not want to tangle with the elephant. Yeah. Oh, well done. Yeah, there they are. All spotted again, Brian. Yeah, just on the other side, trying to get a little gap. Can you see them through there? Again, fortunately, there they go. They're the cubs, everyone. So those of you who were a little bit worried about the cubs, as I said, the lioness has just quickly ran back, got the cubs and got out of there. So you really don't have to worry. So everybody walked out of there fairly unscathed, bar the buffalo that got a few scratches on the back, but I think she will be okay. They're just on the other side of that drainage line again, everyone. So unfortunately, I mean, we did try and look if we could drive through there. It's very thick and I won't be able to get through there. No, they're just lying down now. Which is good news. Oh, that's good. So they'll probably just rest around this area. If there are more buffalo around, they could potentially try later if they do see some more buffalo. And there are a lot of buffalo around at the moment, as we said, and they appear every so often and just shows you how opportunistic these lions are. Feeding on a carcass, but if there's fresh food, they'll go for it. Ruth, I'll answer your question shortly. I just want to move out of the way for this other vehicle. F? They're just on the other side of the drainage line, M4. Just on the other side. You might see them from this side. I'm not sure if you can get through there. Yeah, just have a look over there. And there's some Ellie's around. That's why they chased them. They've been running through. It's been difficult to... Yeah. Enjoy, everybody. Enjoy. Thanks, Ephraim. Just trying to tell them where the lines are so that they can try and get a view. But there are still a few elephants around, so those lions will try and avoid that area. Oh, now I've lost my train of thought. What was the question again? Right. M. Ruth, you asked about the lions being agitated after a situation like that, with them being chased away or losing a kill. I don't think so. I think it would have got the adrenaline going a little bit, that's for sure. But I don't, you know, I think it happens, I know it happens more frequently than we realize. So I don't think they get agitated. I think it's just... It's a situation where they possibly, how do we know how they feel? We don't know. So I just think it's, we lost that one. We'll try for the next one. So I wouldn't say they get agitated at all. I don't think so. That was very, very interesting. Might have to do a little happy dance just now, because that was such a wonderful sighting, a very, very intense sighting. Nice to have a little elephant coming after us, eh, Brian?
Yeah.
All right, well, we're going to carry on driving around and see what else we can find. There's been so much happening this morning. Let's head back to James, who is still apparently out on drive. Let's see what he's up to.
I don't know if you caught that last little bit of the yawn that that Batelier gave everybody. He's obviously very tired. It's Tuesday morning, of course. He's just coming out of a heavy weekend, scratching his ear. We went past him on our way to Cheetah Plains and thought, no, we must quickly get to quarantine. And we didn't stop, but he hasn't moved one inch. Anyway, we left quarantine because he was lurking, doing absolutely nothing in that tree. And, of course, you had that astounding sighting, again, of the Nkuhuma pride, which seems to... I have the opposite effect on them from Byron and Taylor. I inspire them to go to sleep. I bore them to tears to the extent that all they do is lie down and go to sleep when I'm around. And when Byron and Taylor are there, they kill things willy-nilly. Anyway... It's just the way it is, you know, David. Not everybody can find you entertaining. Sometimes nobody. But this is a wonderful picture of the Batelier. Fully mature, using his eyes to scan the landscape for things to kill with those talons that David's showing you. You can see the nictitating membrane there, closing across the eyes. See how quickly it goes? Just cleaning the lenses. Isn't that cool? God, he's a pristine bird, isn't he? And all around, the sounds of the summer are now starting to fill the air. It's really warming up quite nicely. There are cicadas and crickets and grasshoppers and obviously birds. And that stillness that we had at the beginning of the morning is the same now. I was just thinking as we were driving along yesterday, and I had the same feeling when we were at quarantine, while the mayhem that was going on around the Nkuhumas with the elephants and buffalo and killing and all of that sort of stuff going on, so close by, everything just carrying on completely normally. And isn't that a kind of, I suppose, a microcosm of what happens throughout the whole world. It's going to fly, David. It's going to fly. Or turn around and relieve itself. But all around the world, different kinds of tragedies and triumphs are going on, and for most of the rest of us, we just don't notice. And off he goes. He's gone off there. Cool. Well, that was a nice little interlude. I didn't put him to sleep, David.
Nope.
Now, Connor, who was around the Gowri repeater a little bit earlier, said he heard a buffalo bellowing. Unfortunately, we're really already on Cheetah Plains. We're going to just do a quick turn around there. If a buffalo has been killed, it can only have been, I suppose it's possible the Salala pride's come back up here. I suppose it's possible that one of the males or two of the males got hold of them, or maybe they were just having a fight with each other. But we'll go and have a quick look-see. We don't have much time left. I'm just turning the game drive channel up so I can hear what's going on. And so we're going to drive at a relatively high-ish speed. There are some impala there, and they're gathering around the water as it starts to warm up. Hello, JT. You're wondering about old age and whether or not animals ever die of old age or if they just get killed by things here. JT, very few animals, I think, probably die of old age. That said, I think it's more than we think it is. I think that because I've obviously up in East Africa, we know that far more animals, and I think this is fascinating too, this is happening quite a lot now. Far more animals die of natural causes than are killed by predators. And I think that is probably the case here too. I think when animals get old, they probably get sick. And maybe they do just pop off. Anyway, this fighting that's taking place between the males, which is not uncommon, I think is brought on by the fact that I think the hormone levels of the females have probably increased. I think they're probably producing estrogen just before they give birth, that the males can smell, but not to the same extent that they can when they're just about to go into the rut. And I think that's making them a little bit sort of competitive with each other. That's my guess. Would anyone like to confirm or deny that estrogen does get produced in slightly higher levels when just before a female is about to give birth? I think that's what happens. Okay, let's carry on. Now, I've just heard something on the radio. I'm not sure it's... I think those lions have tried to attack another buffalo. I'm not sure. Anyway, they really are quite something. Right, Byron is still not far from those lions. He's at Bivelshoek Dam and he's got something that they don't eat very often here.
Well, we've got a beautiful giraffe standing here now, James. A big male. He didn't drink. I was hoping to see him drink. He may have had a drink already by the time we got here. And yeah, they do not eat giraffe that often, the lions. But I have seen them feeding on giraffe and have seen them hunt giraffe. But yeah, it's not something... I think that's very easy. And the giraffe can do some serious damage with these kicks. They can kick forwards and backwards. Oh, there's a beautiful red-chested cuckoo. Oh, Brian, I think I can see it. At the top of the tree. A dead tree. Hang on, let me see. Let me turn for you. Okay, have you got him? Red-chested cuckoo, everyone. Wonderful. Wonderful. Yay. Now, I know you probably can't tell the difference between my call and the bird call. I won't spoil it for you. We'll listen to the red-chested cuckoo do it. It's a wonderful call. It's a beautiful bird, isn't it, everyone? And you can see that bit of a rufous, reddish-brown coloration around the neck over there. Should have a bit more. This could possibly still be a... I think this might be a female. Let me just have a look quickly. There's another one calling in the distance. Let's just see. I think the male, the male definitely has a lot more rufous and that around the neck and chest area. The younger ones not so much, but anyway, it looks like this one's a little bit. You can still see on the throat. You can see the red or the rufous. All right, James has got some primates he'd like to show you quickly, everyone.
There are a few of them left. It's a very large troop of baboons, this actually. They're heading towards Treehouse Dam, I think. But they were not impressed to see the vehicle. They went scampering off into the bush here. And I think this is the same troop that chased Karula's cubs the first time I saw them being chased by baboons. And they tend to come, they do little forays into the southern end of Juma and then they go back towards Little Gowrie. It's a big troop. There are probably 30 animals here. Now that female, it's just disgusting, but that is seriously attractive to a male baboon. That swollen, dung-encrusted back end is deeply attractive to a male baboon. And that just means she's ready to mate. She's in estrus. And that female obviously isn't. You can see the difference. I wish they weren't so nervous of us, you know, because they're just the best value to watch. I mean, you can sit and watch a troop of baboons for hours. Look at the big one at the back there. He's a very large fellow. His tail's moving. Yeah, that's a formidable animal. He is not to be trifled with. Very, very strong. Not shy of a fight. And that's about the size of the one we saw trying to hook poor little Hosanna out of a tree the other day. So nice to see them. I really do feel we miss out on quite a lot by the fact that we don't see so many baboons around, because their behaviour is, well, it's amusing, it's fascinating, the social structure is incredible, but unfortunately we're unable to unpack it all here. Not sure why. I mean, look, we know why there aren't a lot of baboons around. We think it's probably because of the lack of very big trees for them to roost in. Oh, there's one right in front of us, Dave. In the tree there. Oh, it's got a fright. There it goes. It will be a young male, much the same way that young bull elephants hang off the sort of edge of the herd. So the young male baboons will do the same. Hello, Justin. You're wondering if these baboons are able to paint like the ones in The Lion King. No, they're not painters. I think that the baboon in The Lion King was not... it's interesting. The Lion King, of course, is, apart from being a great story, is the greatest purveyor of biological untruths that there's ever been. But one of the things that's interesting about it is that it was set in East Africa, we think. And the baboon species there that you get is called the olive baboon. And, of course, the baboon in The Lion King, whose name was Rafiki. Rafiki was, I think, a mandrill. So he wasn't actually a baboon. He's a kind of a baboon, but he was a mandrill. And I think mandrills are not found where lions are found. I would actually find, let's find your picture of Rafiki in the book here. So, yes, and yet another misconception that has been perpetuated by The Lion King, that guides around Africa are currently tearing their hair out at, because their guests are coming and asking questions about, you know, Pride Rock and males in the Pride, and, you know, is there always an evil brother in a coalition and that sort of thing. Let me find you a mandrill, because they're quite impressive. The olive baboon looks just about exactly like our baboon. Or a gelada. Maybe it's supposed to be a gelada. Here we go. Yeah, there's a mandrill. That's the one there. Now, I seem to remember Rafiki having a face sort of that colour. Don't you remember that, David?
Yes.
So I think that's what Rafiki was. Yes, there we go. So Rafiki was a mandrill, which is, of course, is only found in the far west of Africa, where there are no plains and very little in the way of lions. He was a medicine man. Maybe he'd come all the way across the continent to spend time with the pride. But, you know, as they say in Hollywood, why let the truth get in the way of a good story? Now, there are two things I wish to achieve in the not-too-distant future. The first is to see the first impala lamb, and the second is to catch a dung beetle live on screen, like that. I've never managed to do it. Now, we are going to go up towards where we think Connor had that maybe bellowing buffalo. Tracy, you're asking about orangutans, and I think you were asking whether or not baboons are closely related or not. They're quite distantly related. Orangutans are, oh, how aggressive are baboons in relation to orangutans? Well, I mean, again, this is interesting. Aggression, Tracy, is something that is, it's quite difficult to define, but I think you'll find that baboons and orangutans are probably similarly aggressive given the same amount of threat. So I'm pretty sure that an orangutan can become extremely aggressive if it's threatened sufficiently. They do live in areas, of course, orangutans, where there are slightly fewer... That's from an old fence, where there are slightly fewer natural predators, I think, than there would be for baboons. So you'll probably find that they are not quite as angry. And also, I think an orangutan lives in a... They live in a harem society. Not exactly sure. I think you'll find that they're probably slightly less prone to violence than baboons are. But, of course, chimpanzees are very violent when they want to be, and they of course are also great apes. So orangutans, chimpanzees, gorillas, gibbons, and bonobos. Yes, Paul, I'm sorry to disappoint you. Indeed, you know, this is going to be a distressing thing for you to hear, but yes, baboons do not hold baby lion cubs up over a rock when they're born. Yeah, you're absolutely right. Sorry about that, Paul. Oh, quickly, Dave. There's a Wahlberg's eagle being savaged by a fork-tailed drongo. I love this. Those little drongos are utterly fearless. Two of them now. Now, Wahlberg's eagle is not even an eater of drongos, really. I mean, I suppose it would eat one if it could catch it. Isn't that cool? And the only way that eagle will escape is to go higher and higher and higher on the thermal that he's on. So cool. And whether he's actually making contact or not, I don't know. That's not a Wahlberg's eagle, you know that, David. Its tail is too wide. So I don't know what it is then. We'll just call it a tawny eagle. I think it is a tawny eagle, actually. When it flapped like that, I could see that the end backs of the wings were slightly darker than the back of the bird. So I think pretty sure that's a tawny eagle. That is so cool. All right, let's just look around here for distressed-looking buffalo with male lions on the back. We don't have much time left. We'll just have a quick drive through here. This is roundabout where Connor said he heard the noise. Now Byron is lurking about, also wondering about lions and buffalo and elephant and contemplating his existence. Let's go and find out what conclusions he's come to.
James, you always make me feel so good about myself. Thank you. basically enjoying the moment after the actual event. It's nice to just now drive around and see what pops up. After such an exciting sighting, you really don't have to find too much else. You can just enjoy being out here, see what birds you bump into. There was a dwarf mongoose that ran in front of us earlier, just ran past us. Only one, didn't see others. They're probably hiding in the bush, in the scrub somewhere.
Zoe. Oh, there's a vulture up at the top. And this question was for Brian. Oh, there it goes. White-back vulture, everyone. Off it goes. And some zebra up ahead. Oh, look at that. There we go, some zebra over there. So, Zoe, you asked Brian if he's going to plant more sunflowers. Brian, did you plant? When did you plant sunflowers?
I planted sunflowers not too long ago. The wilderness came in and ate them. Ate all of them.
Oh,
all my hard work, my babies.
So, are you going to try? Are you going to try plant some more?
No. I won't.
No.
Because them animals are going to come in and eat them again.
So Zoe, the thing is, if you plant beautiful flowers that also taste good, and you get all these animals coming in and feeding on them, so it probably won't be worthwhile. So Brian says no. He's...
I'm bleak with sunflowers now. Very bleak.
Brian's horticulturalist days are over. Sure. Word of the day, James. I hope James heard that one. I think he may be quite impressed. Nice to see a little herd. Actually, quite a big herd of zebras. Quite a few around here. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14. About 16 or so. Just quickly, just a quick count, a quick scan. Counted about 16 or so. Let's see all these animals. We're starting to see a lot more zebra and wildebeest on Juma. Well, I can definitely see a difference in the last 2 weeks I've been here, or 3 weeks actually. Because of all this green grass that has popped up, and there's definitely been an increase in wildebeest and zebra activity around here. Enjoying this area very, very much. And we've been so lucky, everyone, because just south of us, not too far south of us and north of us, there's been very little rain, and a lot of those areas are still looking very barren, and which is not good. So hopefully they will start getting rain soon. We do need a lot of rain. Some beautiful birds calling, the starlings, and it sounds like a white-browed scrub robin calling. Everything seems so peaceful now again. It's amazing how the bush has this ability, or the wilderness has this ability, to go from almost complete chaos to complete calm in a matter of minutes. It's wonderful, really special to see. Magnificent zebra. I do enjoy seeing them. They are beautiful. It's incredible to think that... Oh, an unhappy elephant up ahead. Can't see it. Just heard it calling. That little trumpet. Did you hear that? It sounds like there's a big herd at the dam. Shall we go have a look quickly, everyone? I was just going to say quickly about the zebra. It's fascinating if you think that everyone is completely unique. Their patterns are just like our fingerprints, completely different. And what I also find so fascinating is when the foals are born, the zebra foals, their mothers
pattern is embedded in their memory immediately. So they are able to recognize their mother in a herd of zebra very, very quickly. It's fascinating. Isn't nature wonderful? Oh, here's this elephant. Just having a look at this elephant, it seems very upset about something. It's chasing the zebra. I hope I get this name right. Was it Patton that just asked the question about the zebra and what benefits? Saturn asked the question, wants to know, what are the benefits of the zebra having stripes as opposed to the other animals which don't? And from a ecological evolutionary point of view, what is the benefit? So the theory behind the stripes is that it is a way for the zebra to kind of protect themselves. And I say it's a theory because it hasn't necessarily been proven, 100% proven. But the one theory that I've read up about and that I think is the most plausible is that when these zebra do get chased by something, when they're running in these herds, when they're all running together, it makes it difficult because of these stripes. Oh, this elephant's very upset. While they're running and these stripes are all, or the zebra all close together, these stripes start blending in. And have a look, everyone. There's some elephant just off to our right. Some youngsters are heard. Anyway, so as I was saying, these stripes start blending in, and it makes it difficult for the predator to basically single out an individual when they are hunting. So which makes sense, everybody. And if you do see zebra running together, it does. I mean, if you looked quickly, you wouldn't necessarily be able to see where one starts and one ends. If it's a big herd of zebra, and all I always think, well, if you're trying to count them, it's very difficult at times. So I think that is plausible. And again, we don't really know exactly what these predators see, but apparently they see in black and white, so it might make it a little bit confusing for them. So that is the one theory, and that is the one that I think is probably more plausible. So to answer your question in a nutshell, I think it's purely a case of it may ensure that the zebra stays safe, they can look after one another, they stay together in herds, and that will deter predators from hunting them or make it harder for predators to hunt them, so their lifespan may be a lot longer. So that's why they've evolved like that, I think, possibly. There are other theories that it helps regulate body temperature and that, but I don't think that's 100% true. I don't think so. Anyway, so these elephants seem to be moving off. I just wanted to see if there are some more at the dam. While I do that, let's head back to James and find out what he is contemplating at the moment.
I'm contemplating these buffalo, everybody. Now, we're in and around the area where Connor said he heard the was how he described it to me on the telephone when I phoned him. And they don't seem to be very panicked at all. So I think they were probably just having a fight with each other. It's an interesting group. There's largely males, but one or two cows in the group. Andre, you have got the best idea of anyone that I can imagine. You have said that you've said that when you have children, you will not be you will not be showing them The Lion King. You will be showing them Safari Live. That will save us all a great deal of heartache, I must say. Although the story in The Lion King, while it is a great fallacy, is a good one. And of course the songs, well, the songs, David, they are magnificent too. All right, everyone, that's going to be it from David and I. Remember, we are on Drive this afternoon again from 4 to 7. And if you've been watching on Periscope, thank you, first of all. And secondly, we will be live on Periscope again this afternoon. So until then, stay safe and happy where you are. And I'm going to hand you back, I think, to Byron for the last few minutes of the drive.
Well, thank you very much, James, and I'm sure we'll see James later again. Look here, everybody, there's a herd of elephant around here. Hang on, I'm just trying to see if I can get a nice gap for us to see them. Where's that road? There we go. We might see them coming towards us. That would be nice. Some slightly less aggravated elephant. Well, it really has been a fantastic drive this morning. So exciting. A lot going on. So I hope all of you have enjoyed it as much as we have. Brian and I are still very excited about that sighting. James, you've asked, and you say you often do that. You ask James's question is, can I sum up the sighting that we had with those lions and elephant and buffalo in one word? One word, sure. Let me think quickly, James. I would say sure. I don't know.
Spectacular.
Spectacular, Brian, is that your word? Spectacular, magnificent.
Awesome.
Intriguing. Intriguing. I think I would go with intriguing. Because there was a lot going on and we didn't know how it was going to end. And so it was, yeah. So I'm going to go intriguing. Again, thank you very much to all our viewers for all your comments and questions and joining us today. It really, really is always fantastic hearing from all of you. And glad that you could enjoy it so much with us. Dina, you say your word would be exhilarating. Wonderful. Yeah, exhilarating, definitely. Look at these elephants coming out towards us now and the little ones. Just quickly, those viewers who joined us on Periscope this morning, it will be up again this afternoon, so you can watch via Periscope, which is great. Just another way for more people to join us on Safari Live and get to witness all these wonderful animals and experiences with us, which is so important and so wonderful. Oh, this is lovely. What a way to end. Isn't this fantastic, everyone? Lovely way to end the show. There's a large one coming through the bush there. So, thank you very much again to everybody. Thank you to my friend Brian for amazing camera work this morning and the thumb. It was really great, Brian. Thank you. Thank you to Lou and Kirst in the final control. And, of course, thank you to James and Dave. Always wonderful being on Drive with them. We're going to watch these elephants again. And thank you. Don't forget to join us this afternoon on Safari Live. And we will see you then. Have a wonderful day or evening wherever you are in the world. Goodbye, everybody.